Can you tell us what you
were doing? I was doing an interview.
Sure.
After this.
After this.
Well, I'm a jazz musician. You don't ask me questions like this.
Are you working on anything?
No. What?
Are you working?
We're always working on a new record. I'm a composer. I'm a jazz musician. Yeah.
Are you playing trio?
Classes, compositions, 25 hours a day.
Are you playing trio tonight?
Yeah, we have Belden Bullock, young bass player.
You playing
New York City, and George Gray also from New York City.
You play so many ways, like solo and duets and trios and quartets and big bands. Do you prefer anything?
Well, it depends on how much money they pay me.
Yeah. What about for the music?
We have no problem with music. Music is not really our problem.
I was thinking, like, for me, my favourite music for me is when he was playing with Johnny Deani.
Oh, yeah, Johnny was an incredible musician.
Is that say something about that time, Johnny?
Johnny?
Yeah. Now he's gone.
Johnny was a... okay. In any musical culture, you know, in any country, there's continuity. You know, if you take jazz music in the United States, for example, you know, if you start, say, with people in New Orleans, like Armstrong and Freddie Keppard, then there's a lineage of trumpet players right up to Winton. You can actually trace every generation. Piano players, the same thing. In South Africa, what happened is that apartheid eradicated a whole generation. You know, they just died. Some of them in exile. And Johnny was one of the musicians. They came out with a group called the Blue Notes. With Chris McGregor leading them. That was the generation just behind us, or in front of us. So when they left there, Johnny was 16, Mongezi, Feza trumpet player, 14 years of age. And all of them died in London. Every single one of them. The only one that's left is Lewis, the drummer.
What killed them?
Well, in a way you can say apartheid killed them. See, when you were in South Africa at the time, you had a choice, you see? Either you stayed there, and if you stayed, you either had to stop playing the music or you have to go into get a day job and try to play. There's no way that you can operate as a professional. So, most of us left because... And also the movement in the ANC asked us to play a more visible role in the struggle. But there are several reasons for taking that decision, because number one, we had to get out of there to preserve our own sanity. The other reason was that we had to preserve a culture that was disintegrating. At that time, I was one of the few musicians who at least had a high school education. Most of those musicians hardly got past primary school. They were incredible musicians. So again, it's the legacy of apartheid. So when they came abroad, the only thing that stood between them and starvation was the instrument. I know they were offered several scholarships, but they couldn't fulfill these scholarships because they didn't have the basic. It was a very big education school. So, the answer is that it was a partner that killed them.
Is it also possible that it might have been that people just didn't survive here because they missed South Africa?
It's possible. Sure, it's still. It's apartheid. But when you go into exile and miss South Africa, stuff. It was a hard choice. It was a hard choice for people to make, to say, okay, that you actually decide to go into exile. Exile with families, you know. All our families have been disrupted. My family is disrupted, I think. I mean, they didn't grow up in a normal family or extended family situation. You lived in exile, you had a... You lived in exile, there was no support. No family support.
How do you see the situation now in your native South Africa? How do you feel when you're there? Obviously the strong vestiges of the apartheid.
Okay.
How much has it changed? How much is it
changed? Are we changing it? It's not necessary or not even possible or advisable for us to sit and wait for somebody else to do it. We're changing it ourselves. So, you see, what needs to be done is that we have been in activist mode all these years. Now it's like proverbial beating swords into plowshares. Definitely change our mindset. It's also, at the same time, very exciting because it's the only place left in the world where you can actually change things from the ground up. You know, South Africa is like the last frontier of humanity. It's not just a question of black and white in South Africa or race, it's a question of the human race. Because we were given the task in the dubious dignity of dismantling apartheid, because apartheid exists everywhere in the world. Apartheid, the idea of apartheid has nothing to do with the color. It's a concept of... Let me put it this way, you can't throw anything out of the universe. If you move something, you know, like the concept of apartheid, if you move something from one place to the other, you move people, it's still within the universe. So we understand the unity within everything. So in Islam we say Tawhid. Tawhid is the unity. Unity within everything. Tao in Chinese. The way. That's why we practice music, we practice martial arts. It's the same principle of this internal energy that flows through everything. So the concept of apartheid started when people thought that they could separate things. Now we have a monocrop. You have a farmer who only grows potatoes, and you have another farmer who only grows squash, and another one only grows maize. There's a very interesting project in Natal. It's a traditional farmer. It's the Mazibuku. Now what he's done, he's taken in the Natal area, working with women, started this project with women. And everybody has a little piece of land, you see. So he instituted or reinstituted the whole process of traditional farming. And they've been very successful. They've become self-sufficient up to a point now where they even export. Up to a point now where people come from all over the world to study with them. Up to a point where they export people from these farms elsewhere in the world to go and reintroduce traditional farming. Now what happens in traditional farming, you see, the elders have a this knowledge of how to mix certain plants. you know, so maybe you take three or four plants, and these plants are complementary. Sow them together, they grow together. So they complement each other, so you don't need pesticides. Okay? The moment you have monocrop, you have to have pesticides, because you have destroyed the interrelationship with things. So that's where the concept of apartheid. So if you go to a general practitioner and you tell him that you've got a stomach problem, then he will tell you that he can't treat you because he's an eye specialist. This is apartheid. The concept of apartheid is the concept of breaking the unity of
separation.
God's universe.
How much do you think apartheid still continues today?
Pardon?
I know Thabo Mbeki said recently that South Africa was still a divided nation.
You see what I'm saying? Our universal minds are in a state of apartheid. Apartheid is not a problem of South Africa. Apartheid is a universal situation. We were just given the task as the forerunners in South Africa to have to deal with it. You know? People all over the world have to deal with it, with apartheid existing within themselves. Yeah? We have to thank people from our president, Nelson Mandela, and all these incredible leaders and people that we have, these old, our elders who are unsung. Yeah? We don't hear of them, but we study with them. We study with them as a whole. There was a shooting last yesterday in Washington. You know about it? Yeah. We're starting music academy, starting one in Johannesburg and one in Cape Town. We've been at this project now for many years. We've just been given access to the Cape Town City Hall. In fact, we're talking to Shadow Twala and then Pierre. What's the station? So what is the station in Cape Town, the radio? And also with Kaya FM in Johannesburg to give us support. So we started these music academies, one in Johannesburg. In Johannesburg, our record company has given us the sixth floor of the building. In Cape Town, we have access to the City Hall. So our music academy, we're starting on the 1st of September. It's going to be an international academy. More than an academy, it's going to be a research academy. And not just focusing on music, we have to have a total broader spectrum of activity.
And what's
the
your
music? Pardon?
What's your role in that?
I'm creative. In terms of giving creative ideas for people to execute. But the courses will be music, of course all the aspects of music, which is like composition, performance skills, but also to give people empowerment in terms of giving them skills for tour management, or marketing, public relations, all related avenues of the music industry. And we also do a holistic sense, holistic area. We have integrated the traditional healers, also general practitioners, acupuncturists from China, Japan, linguists. South Africa is the key, not just to South Africa, but the key to the planet. We say, last November we played a concert we did a tour of South Africa, and we played in the Sudwala Caves. You know the Sudwala Caves? Sudwala Caves is in Mpumalanga. Mpumalanga is Mpumu. Mpuma means to come out. Langa is the sun. So and where the sun comes out. It's the eastern part of South Africa, next to the Swazi border. Incredible, incredible part of the world. We played a concert in a cave that is 250 million years old. Right? It has an amphitheater, about 600 seat, a natural amphitheater. Now, if you take 400 years of colonialism and compare it to 250 million years, this is nothing. Look at where our mindset is at. This is the glory of Africa. The time is the great liberator.
Do you feel that in so-called post-apartheid South Africa, there are different influences? There's perhaps less a different kind of drive on musicians, or a different kind of influence on musicians working today than you had in the old days when you were in exile or
I don't understand your question.
Well, have the influences changed on musicians, given that the environment has changed somewhat?
I don't care where music goes, you can go to hell too. My interest is not in music, my interest is in the hearts and minds of people. You know, the idea for starting these music academies is not to create a nation of musicians. You know, it's to give us empowerment. You know? And music is the resource that we have at our behest and still in our control. We should be able to have people access every other kind of information. You know, this music serves as a dynamo. And it doesn't matter in what field you activate, music is an integral part of your life. Yeah? So for us, music has got nothing to do with writing hits. You know, when we become superstars, this is a strange concept for us.
Is there anyone?
When you start your work as a composer, you don't just listen to everything. One young musician once asked John Coltrane, he said, "Train, what books must I use?" And Train said, "All the books." So every book that you can find, so every... Did you hear that? That's an influence.
You spoke with incredible optimism about South Africa and empowering people. Do you think that the optimistic wave that South Africa is going through or has gone through is likely to last?
The universe is a safe place. It's only when people get to it. You know? So it's got nothing to do with nothing.
What do you think of the people?
Well, this is what we're saying. We have been given the task in South Africa to change it, and we are blessed that we have somebody like the President Mandela. And that concept of reconciliation. Because the change has to come from within.
Are you positive about the future?
Say that question. Why don't you ask that question for yourself? You mean, just say it for yourself and then hear what you're saying.
I'm asking whether you think that the people who will continue to run South Africa.
The universe is a safe place. There's nothing. Nothing to worry. The only thing that we have to do is it's got nothing to do with somebody else, it's got to do with you. It's like sometimes we have an interview, what's his name, a tenor player, once asked a journalist, and the journalist kept on asking him, and he said to me, you think it's about you? No? The music that we play has got to do with us. The situation in South Africa is not got to do with South Africa, it's got to do with humanity, it's got to do with what is in our hearts. How do we change it? This is what we have to address. That's why I'm saying South Africa is a prime example for the rest of the world. And also I think the way that the people go about solving problems in South Africa is incredible. You know, it's fantastic because I know when the whole discussion started, the idea of dialogue, all of that was done not in public. No? And then finally when it was resolved, there was a statement made. Nowadays everything, negotiations is done on television. So everybody brings their own agenda.
Maybe just if nobody else has one, can I just ask a very light-hearted question, which is your response to the cousin's marriage?
It's a good idea. We have to congratulate. See, there again is always the music. Music. Playing a major role in the Marcella. She's the widow of Samora Bush. And we played there during Frelimo's time before the president died. Now Gracia is a musician. She's a pianist. She was in the music conservatory studying to become a pianist when the war broke out, and she left him and joined the project. So within all, every dynamic in South Africa was always the element of music. So for us, music is not something, it's not something apart that we have to go and do somewhere. An integral part of our existence. South Africa is the only place in the world where a revolution was done in four-part harmony. You could point to a four-part harmony. You're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.
You're welcome.